Hey everyone, so you may be one of these people that's still looking to crush it on ChatGPT, where you see your friends or colleagues, you know, are just like racing ahead and using it 50 times a day. Or maybe you're somebody that uses it and you've been trying to teach like your teammates or your friends or your mom, like how to use this. And at first they seem like they really get it, but then a week later they're not really using it. So there's a lot of reasons why that is, but I'll tell you one of the ways that I've gotten people over that hump. And I call it the productivity versus creativity dilemma. And here's the thing, instinctively, we want to help people be more productive because you're a good soul that just wants to help the world. So when I was doing this initially, I was just teaching people productivity. Here's how you make your work faster and better quality and everything like that. And that's great. But then I realized that people weren't really sticking to it and I needed something to stick in their head that would make them do it more. That's when I almost accidentally, to be totally honest, switched over to creativity. Why? Because creative things tend to stick in their brain and that's when the dopamine starts hitting and that's when people really get fired up and start figuring out their own use cases. By the way, this is why kids are great at ChatGPT. Not because they're like, hey, I think I'm going to cheat on my homework, because God forbid. But instead they think, hey, I wonder if ChatGPT can do this. Chances are they can, and it feels like magic. So let me show you two demos, just real quick, of what I mean by the productivity versus the creativity, and see if you don't agree. So let's talk productivity versus creativity. So let's start with the productivity. This is a great and easy one, right? It's writing emails, right? So we might say, write an email to my boss explaining why I need 6 more headcount, right? So we're going to do that. And this is a great way to show people how great ChatGPT is at writing emails. Now, remember that ChatGPT doesn't know who you are, who your boss is, what industry you're in, anything. And yet it's writing this unbelievably persuasive email. That's pretty cool, right? And then you could kind of go on and on around this, and I usually do, but then it might not stick in the same way as if you did something like this. Okay, yeah, that's great. Wow, oh my gosh, like outline the reasons why an increase of 6 headcount is necessary. It's incredible, right? It's like, great. Now remember that I'm trying to suck up to my boss and she is obsessed with monster trucks. Now write it again. So now you're going to show how ChatGPT can personalize an email extremely well and extremely quickly. Dear boss's name, turbocharging our team with 6 more headcount as we continue to steer our team towards ambitious terrains like a monster truck at a championship rally. So, and then of course, you know, more horsepower, specialized pit crew, well-being. I don't know how that fits in, but you can see, right? That right away, people are probably going to remember more about this whole monster truck thing. It's sort of funny. And it actually just sticks in your brain more than the email part, just than a straight email, right? So that's one example. Let me just show you another example. Let's just open up another chat. And let's say one of my favorite uses, by the way, of ChatGPT is ChatGPT is amazing at creating humans, right? So it's something I call the infinite focus group, which I'll probably do again in future things, but infinite focus groups are phenomenal for sales teams, marketing teams, anything else. So I already copied this in here. I'm developing a new organic vegetables company. I need a focus group. Pretend I'm walking into a middle America grocery store and give me a diverse group of 5 individuals with their names, ages, and backgrounds. That's really, really helpful, but also make one of them an alien and give them really weird characteristics. So I don't know what this is going to do. Let's find out together. Okay, so Jim is 42, a construction worker, married, has 2 kids. So you can see that ChatGPT, by the way, you can do this an infinite amount of times, just create more and more focus groups. It's unbelievably practical. And look, it's a pretty diverse group and everything. And then number 5 is Zorglox, unknown age, background, extraterrestrial being, physical characteristics, blue translucent skin, which can change color based on mood, 4 arms, okay, eyes, that stalks. Very intrigued by the concept of organic. Okay, great. So what might Zorglox like in a veggie, right? Why not start with Zorglox? Because you know that we're going to get to all the boring stuff. Well, Zorglox might be drawn to vegetables with vivid colors and distinctive textures, appreciating the sensory aspect. Do you see the point here? There's a real lesson in here. The real lesson is infinite focus groups actually have an incredible productive use case. But by doing the creative thing, it just shows people, holy cow, like this is going to go way beyond what their brain conceives of as a normal use case and gives them just so much more freedom and creativity. This is the way that it sticks in your brain. This is where the dopamine starts hitting. And this is a great way to teach ChatGPT and other large language models. And that's it. Super simple. But just remember, when you're teaching people something, don't just go to, you know, the super practical, the productivity. It's like kids, and it's like how you used to learn as a kid. What do you remember? You remember the things that were inherently entertaining. That's number one. But number two, also, creativity is just a better way to learn ChatGPT because it gets the dopamine going. It stays sticky in their brain, and it shows off the power of ChatGPT so that they can take it forward and start getting creative on their own. And that, I promise, will translate into productivity. Just give it time. But this is the best way that I've found to train people.